Okay, so up next we have Ryan Prosser, who is the CEO of Very, and Keith Nothaker, who is the CEO of Backtrack. They are going to talk about how IoT is revolutionizing the journey to sobriety. Welcome, Ryan and Keith. Just one second, I have to get microphones.
Hi, everybody. More in his feed.
On. Test.
All right, let's do it. All right, let's get into it. So this is Keith, CEO of Backtrack. What we're going to talk about today a little bit is the product development process when you're working with outside developers. And Keith has an extremely interesting product that I thought I'd have him introduce himself and tell us a little bit about Backtrack and the things they're doing to help people on their journey to sobriety. So Keith, tell us just a little bit about Backtrack.
Sure. Hello, everyone. Again, Keith Nothaker, CEO of Backtrack. We make breath alcohol testers and wearable alcohol detectors. I'm looking out, and it looks like a lot of people who are 0.00 BAC right now. Hopefully drinks in the back later.
Right,
but,
right.
But
zero
we're experts in that. We make Bluetooth-connected breath alcohol testers that connect to a smartphone, and people can estimate their alcohol level.
So, okay, for reference, this was the state of play not that many years ago. This would be something that you would wear on your ankle. This would monitor your BAC level. This would probably be radio, I guess, at that time, yeah. So this would be transmitted over radio, huge, you know, wear on your ankle type deal, maybe on your wrist if you want to have, like, just a huge deal. And you could see on the inside, I mean, there's just a ton happening. Like, this was what the world looked like at that time. And this is extremely intrusive for a person that's struggling with alcohol. That's probably a court mandated thing that you have to wear this in order to be able to drive, whatever. Keith, can you show us what it looks like now? What is the state of play in 2019?
Sure. So we've been developing a prototype for a while now, and I'm wearing one right now.
So
this is transdermally measuring any alcohol that's coming out through my skin. So this is, again, not out for public use yet. But this is something that we've been working on for a long time, and we'll transfer your data through a smartphone to the cloud.
So, and if I understand correctly, transdermal, we're not talking about, so there's no breath here, right? This is, it's measuring, what is it measuring exactly?
When you drink alcohol, about 1% of the alcohol you consume is transpired through your skin. And not a lot of people realize that. People see it most frequently if they have a lot to drink, and you say, wow, this guy over here, he smells like alcohol.
This guy smells like
Jaeger. Reason is because the alcohol is actually coming out of your skin. So we decided to take our sensor technology that we had with breath test devices, miniaturize it, make it attractive for consumer use, and make it something that people would want to use.
So, okay, question. You've taken this company a long way. So you founded this company 14 years ago or so. Kind of a unique Silicon Valley story, no outside investment. You've had to do this yourself, which has meant that you've had to solve some difficult problems. You haven't been able to just throw huge money at development. You've had to solve it. Can you talk a little bit about, as you're developing technology that doesn't exist, hardware is hard. Everybody here knows hardware is hard. What have been some of the things you've learned in the product development process as you've worked with outside vendors? What are some mistakes you've made? What are some things you've learned that works? Can you talk about that a little bit?
Sure. Ryan, you mentioned one of the key parts of our company. We've never taken outside funding before. So we've always had to be very, very focused on what is the true need? What does the customer want? And we've been very lean in developing MVP products. What's the minimum viable product that we can make that is accurate, reliable, and that we can put out there for real use? So finding a partner that has similar principles and can really execute and not go run off in one direction and you know, spend a bunch of money or a bunch of time that way, we're focused. We know what we have to build, And we need a partner that can build it quickly, on budget, and make it work best in class.
Interesting. Talk a little bit about, so you've been in IoT since before IoT was IoT. What have you seen develop over time? What are some of the things as you're seeing this space? This is obviously a large device, and it does less than yours, right? And it's significantly larger. Can you talk about some of the major evolutions you've seen and how you guys have incorporated that into some of the products you've rolled out?
Yeah, sure. So we made dumb breathalyzers for a long time. We made breath alcohol testers that would show your blood alcohol content on the device. And we put out the first smartphone-connected breathalyzer in 2013. I have it in my pocket here. So we took what was big, chunky law enforcement technology, and again, we shrunk it down, and we said, hey, anybody can keep this in their pocket or in their car. And with IoT and having access to people's smartphones and their locations and doing that, we've been able to come up with features that we never would have created with a dumb breathalyzer, a standalone. And so, for example, we leverage the screen size now on everyone's device, and we have more information about somebody's alcohol level. We have a patented feature called Zero Line that will show people how long until their BAC returns to zero. And it's something that it didn't make sense to have on the standalone Backtrack breathalyzer, but when you're connected to a smartphone and you have all this technology built in there that you don't even have to sell to the customer, it opens up all these new feature possibilities.
Interesting. And you mentioned like what I would call miniaturization. So taking something that used to be much larger, when I think of a breathalyzer, you know, I definitely don't think of like something that looks more akin to a Tic Tac container.
Thank you, I think.
What would you say? Talk about that process of like taking an existing technology, trying to improve it, but also shrinking it down. From an engineering perspective, what are some of the things you guys have had to solve for or challenges that you've had to overcome? Can you talk about that a little bit?
Yeah, I think that everybody on a design team has a slightly different incentive. So one engineer might want to maximize this part of the equation, and somebody else might say this. And it really, it takes a quarterback who's really involved in all the different parts, or really more of a head coach, who can say, you know what? We are going to make our bomb cost fractionally more because that'll allow us to shrink the device down a little bit more. So you have these trade-offs all the time, and if you have the wrong people making the calls, you're going to have something that might not perfectly answer the customer need. It might not be a commercial success. So you really have to be thoughtful about, like I said before, what are you trying to accomplish? How cost effectively can you build that? Who's your partner that can help you build that? And you know, then you have a product, then the fun begins. Then you have to sell it and try to make money.
So you talked on the front side about working with leveraging third-party vendors and partners and things as you're developing technology. Can you talk about some unsuccess stories, times where you thought you were getting into something that was going to work and it didn't, and maybe why it was unsuccessful? Maybe something that folks here, as they're thinking about a hardware product they want to develop, things to avoid, things that you wouldn't have thought of at that time, but now you know, hey, I don't think this is going to work, and here's why.
Yeah, you always have to work with the best people. I'm not saying anything that people don't know. We want to work with experts in our space. So whether it is internal knowledge that we've developed that relates to an alcohol sensor, because that's a tricky thing. Believe it or not, it's a hard problem to make an accurate, stable alcohol tester. So understanding what type of knowledge you have internally and the people who have that knowledge and leveraging that in the best possible way, that's just been critical for our success. And a long time ago, when we thought we had people in that space related to the alcohol sensor technology that maybe weren't as expert as we thought, that sets you back years. So for us specifically, and something that's so important and as an alcohol tester, right, making sure people have accurate results, having that expertise is crucial.
And I mentioned that you guys have been in the space for a while. Backtrack is one of the OGs of the IoT world. What would you tell somebody today in 2019 that's thinking about developing a hardware product, a software-enabled hardware product today? They're just getting started. They're thinking about how to attack the problem. So you're answering in the abstract, just a theoretical problem. What guidance would you give a person like that?
Yeah, I'm all about the MVP. I've been dollar constrained forever. Again, never had outside capital. It seems fun to have tens of millions of dollars and raise money from the Valley, but when you're really focused on a customer need, that forces you to build just the smallest iteration you can and get it out there to people. Just with any technology, Arduino and anything to prototype something, the bar is so low.
One of the things that we've been hearing more, so we do a lot of software development work. We are an IoT software development shop. We software enable hardware devices. One of the things that we're hearing more and more and pushing, I think, more and more is this idea of an MMP. So MVP is like, let's get a couple units in the wild in trusted spaces, and then MMP is, you know, minimal marketable product, something you can actually stand behind and market and maybe warranty and things like that. Did Backtrack take an approach like that at all? Have you guys had an in-between step there between full commercialization and let's get some things out there? Was that something you guys ever experimented with?
Yeah, you know, we have to be careful, again, because of the type of product we make.
Right.
Device where we have to register with the Food and Drug Administration, the FDA.
Right.
So we have to be careful what we put out for commercialization and make sure that it is accurate, reliable, and safe for people to use. I'd say certainly internally we think about that bar that you mentioned. What is the minimum marketable product? What incremental features by having a smartphone kind of connected product will make it more marketable, will allow us to double our margin because we have additional features? We grew into having a service where somebody could monitor somebody else's alcohol level. And as we move to software, it's sort of a software program that's hardware enabled, that provides tremendous value to people. And especially people who have a serious alcohol or addiction problem, they can monitor somebody else's sobriety remotely. This could have never been done 10 years ago before everybody had a smartphone with GPS, with a high resolution camera, with the Bluetooth connectivity to a Backtrack. So I think it's so easy now to integrate everything together and create real value for customers.
So for those of you who maybe don't recognize the Backtrack brand name, but you feel like you've met Keith somewhere before and you can't place it, Keith is frequently called upon by a lot of the daytime judge shows, Judge Judy and things like that, and Backtrack is asked to preside over various alcohol-related cases. What can you tell us about those appearances? Have they impacted product development in any way or had some unexpected outcome on the business that you can share with us?
You know, I wish I could claim that I was on Judge Judy, some other shows, you know, Dr. Phil and the doctors, but it's all about being out there and seeing how people react, seeing what do they want, what are their problems, really like living and breathing it. I remember when we were developing a product a decade ago, and we would tweak the firmware and collect some data during the daytime and adjust it, and we'd take it out at night, and we have to go out to bars, and we would offer to pay people's alcohol tabs if they would blow into our product. And people thought it was a trick at first. They're like, you're going to pay for my alcohol, and I get to blow into this breathalyzer. And we said, absolutely. So we were out there living it. We were adjusting based on data we collected that night. Again, those were the earlier days. We have a more rigorous test system now. But that's what it's all about. That's what it's all about.
We also, this was before either of us was married or had kids, so we could go do product development in a bar. It was a lot easier to do at that time.
Now my wife is the subject more oftentimes than me getting to go out. So yes, things have changed.
I definitely want to leave at least a minute for a question or two, but I guess a final question would be, you know, as you look back at the what you've been through, it's very rare in the Valley to self-fund and things like this. You know, what has been, do you think, the biggest challenge that you've had to solve for, whether it's outside partner or anything else, that you could share with folks about founding an IoT company that has made it, you know, big time? You guys are doing great. What's been the biggest thing that you've had to overcome, you think? Single biggest hurdle?
Yeah, you said it before. Everybody knows it. Hardware is hard.
Yeah.
It's expensive. It's really expensive. And so we were only able to put towards development the money that we made selling other devices. So that's been very hard. And I think that's caused us to have a slower path versus a hockey stick and straight up. But that's allowed us to develop expertise throughout the years, to really take our time, understand the fundamentals, work with great groups, and Ryan, you know, we work with your company, and you guys have really helped us. Very is here, and you guys have been fantastic for us in accomplishing the goals that we need to accomplish, doing it on time and on budget, and that's allowed us to really scale. You know, our products are in major national retailers. Our products are in Best Buy stores. You know, who would have thought you could go into a Best Buy and get a breath alcohol tester? But we've been able to do that because we can accomplish things efficiently, on budget, and really commercialize them quickly.
Should we go to the audience for one question? We have 2.5 minutes. Anybody out there? We got a gentleman in the back.
Here, you take mine because you're going to answer.
Hi, my name is Tori Smith. I'm the CEO and co-founder of Endiotics. We're making tiny medical robots that you swallow, drive them around in your guts, diagnosing and treating illness in real time. Any advice for someone that's making a device that has the power to save someone's life, or if hacked or misused, take someone's life? Thank you.
No, you.
I thought I had a tough challenge. You are really, you're swallowing a lot. There we go. Any advice? Despite, I obviously don't know what your funding levels are, what your budgets are, there's always the bar that's the regulatory bar, that's the legal bar, that's the public acceptance bar. So, you know, at times you want to think, oh, do we have to do that? But you do. You have to understand from the get-go all the hoops you have to jump across throughout the hardware development cycle, and even when you're out selling. I think of all the times that we've had a regulatory issue that is more money than we thought, more time, not necessarily in a bad way, but just being aware of that to put a device out there. Because for everything I said about having an MVP and just hacking something together, We're in the United States. We have to put out an accurate, trusting, reliable product. So it helps to understand what bar you have to cross at the very beginning.
I think we're at time. You know, I would just say that one of the things that I think is remarkable about your product and also makes it so hard is being off by a little bit matters a lot in your business, right? There's these thresholds. You're on the wrong side of that threshold and you're in big trouble. You know, can you quickly, I get in 10 seconds, talk to us about that level of accuracy and how you, as a culture, can you talk about how you've solved for that at Backtrack?
I mean, you nailed it with culture. You have to have that culture and embed it with everybody everywhere and say, hey, this matters. Let's not worry about this error, these devices. Let's worry about every single thing, every result, every customer. So that's critical, getting that out to your entire organization.
Great. Thank you, everybody, for your time. Keith from Backtrack.
Thank you.